Lance, first of all, let me say I'm really honored to be invited at this event as a representative of a small company in Amsterdam. We only have three people and one intern who is effectively an employee. And to an event that hosts so many of the biggest names in the world, I'm frankly amazed that I'm speaking right after the senior vice president of CNN. I was just twittering my parents like, dude, this is amazing. And they're like rushing home to get the live stream. So hello, people. I hope everybody at home sees me. In this talk, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the vision behind OChoose, and then by way of some snapshots, I'm going to also tell you about some of the challenges that we faced developing this product. First of all, because probably not many of you know what OChoose are, OChoose are 100% non-toxic, biodegradable shoes that bloom. So you buy our shoes, you use them, like I'm wearing them right now. And then when they're worn out, you bury them in the ground, and then the seeds in the tongue, as you water them, will grow out into a beautiful bouquet of flowers. Now, why did I go and do that is the first question that most people ask me after saying, oh, that's so interesting. Why did I go and do that? Well, the answer is storytelling. We all know storytelling as a tool for marketing, where we create a story and an experience around a product or service that in and of itself doesn't really do much of anything. And as I was studying industrial design in Delft, in Holland, I realized that products carry layers of meaning, and that as a product designer, you can deliberately embed layers of meaning into a product. So I wanted to study this this theory, so I went to Sydney, Australia, as you do when you go and study a theory. And I looked at the oral storytelling tradition, like this gentleman illustrates, and basically took the elements of oral storytelling and translated them into design parameters. And I'm not going to go into the whole theory, but one of the major, or actually the most important element of a successful story is a proposal to think or act differently. And so that was my challenge. After I wrapped up in Sydney, I had a theory called storytelling through product design, and I thought, okay, I want to put this into practice and see how this works. So what was the proposal I was going to do? Well, why not, in all of my modesty, take the biggest challenge our world is facing right now, and of course the reason that we're all here right now, namely the fact that we live in an industrial world closed off mostly of our natural world, ironically exemplified by the fact that we are all sitting here in a dark cavern surrounded by electronics and iPods and laptops, etc., while outside, you know, the sun is shining, the weather is sweet. But we're here with a good purpose, so nothing bad about this. What's characteristic of our industrial society is that it's, of course, it's a product of Enlightenment thinking. Enlightenment thinking is rational thinking. It's linear thinking. And in terms of product use, it comes out as the idea that you buy a product, you use it, and you throw it out, and you don't really think about what happens after you throw it out. Whereas in nature, of course, it uses something, and when it's done using it, it throws it out, and this thing decays, and it becomes a source of new life. Now, the goal of sustainability, to me, quite simply put, is reconciling these two worlds, so the reconciliation between our industrial world with our natural roots. So you unite these two to create a world that's sustainable and that can, you know, face the future, at least until some meteor hits us and wipes us all out in one blow. Shoes, I didn't mention why I came around making shoes. Well, actually, that's pure coincidence. I came back from Australia. I was looking for a graduation project to put this into practice. I looked at the database, and I like shoes. I found a project revolving around shoes. I thought, cool, I'll go and make shoes. And in terms of storytelling, how am I going to communicate this message of the natural cycle to an industrial public, basically. You have to create a relevant context. And so I wanted to create a sneaker silhouette that was relevant to an urban public, so make them look good, basically. And then put in a way where they actually can experience their place in natural in the natural world, to create a shoe that blooms. Because when you create a shoe that blooms, as you bury the shoe and the flowers grow out, you become part of the cycle of nature. So by experience, the story is told to the user. And I think that's the most effective way of transferring a message. So much for the vision. It's all great to have ideas. I've heard a lot of theories here as well. It's all cool, and you know, more power to you. But putting it into practice is really something else. I started sketching, of course, at the end of 2008 when I, you know, finally sort of grabbed my courage together and said, okay, I'm going to do this. And it came out with four sneaker designs, basic sneaker silhouettes, and went to work with this. First off, you know, you have to find materials. And I didn't really know anything about making shoes, so I had to also find out how in God's name do you make shoes. Well, I talked to a lot of people in the industry and about my plans, and they all said, well, Chris, that's a great idea. I mean, it's impossible because shoes are stiff with glue, and we don't know of any glue that's fit to make shoes, so good luck. It'll never happen, but if you want a chance to find the materials that you need, go to Italy, and there's a big fair there, and you know, you can find your materials there, hopefully. So I went to Italy and said, hi, I'm Chris from Amsterdam. I'm making biodegradable shoes. You can bury them, they grow flowers. And and basically they looked at me like I had smoked a little bit too much of the local herb. So it was a frustrating 2 days. But at the end of the second day, I found a company that could make biodegradable plastic, soft biodegradable plastic that I now use for the soles. So when I found that, I thought, sweet, you know, the rest is just stitching some textiles together and I'll be fine. Little did I know that it took another 2.5 years to actually develop the shoes. Other sources of information, I had to really study biopolymers and the state of technology. I talked to a lot of other sustainable, just people with sustainable ideas. Basically, you just, you know, like we do here at night, you just have a drink together and you talk to each other and exchange ideas. And finally, we spent countless hours on the internet just talking to suppliers and asking people, like, can I bury your product in the ground and will it degrade? And most people are like, I don't know, man. What do you want about? So finally, we found materials. Like I said, we found the plastic. We found a beautiful herringbone hemp from Romania. We found cork for the insole, biocotton for the laces, PLA for the filler. We're all set to go. Let's make these shoes. Oh, he didn't find any glue. And that's really a problem in the shoe industry, because a guy in Portugal actually told us, you know, I can do this for you, it's good. But we use polyester and we use glue. Because it's a good idea, but it's impossible. 100% is God. You are not God. It's impossible. Which may be a test to my arrogance, thinking, you know, this is possible. But I found Anna. And Anna is a shoemaker in Italy. She's been making shoes by hand for 35 years. And she makes, Anna's the woman on the left, by the way. Woman on the right is a translator from the States. And she makes shoes, amongst other things, for plays, Roman plays. So she makes sandals and stuff without using glue. And she was up to the challenge of trying to create these shoes with me. So, just to illustrate, at first I made a slip-on because I figured without laces it's probably easier to go. And I had a Dutch girl make a first sample just, you know, to see what we could do and how far along we would be. And it sort of looks like it's been dug up in the Middle East. Actually, at the time, I was pretty happy to sort of have something slightly similar to what I wanted to have. But, you know, it was clear we had a long way to go. So this is Anna at the at the sewing machine, and we, you know, put together patterns. She starts sewing, and I sort of adjusted all the patterns on the last to make them look better. And we had to find a mold, and then halfway we sort of found something that was slightly similar to what I wanted to have. But then the mold maker started to spell tau on the soles of the shoe instead of oat, so I had to talk to him about that. And he acted like it was normal. He's like, no, you read from the heel to the toe. So it says, oh, you know, it's fine. And then there was this little weird bits and pieces on the, oh yeah, and the soles started melting, because apparently when you shape a shoe, finally you have to put it in an oven so that it really, you know, sits around the last and you get a good shape. But then our plastic is a thermoplastic, so the shoe is melted during the final stage of production, which caused the soles to melt, caused the eyelets to melt, and we were stuck with sort of half molten shoes. Then finally, we were so close. We had the construction figured out, and the shoes were coming in. We were on a deadline. We had to launch, and the shoes were coming in, and we like seriously, you know, waited the whole morning, staring out the door, waiting for the TNT guy to come in, unpack the box, and the colors of the soles were inverted. And so we had to ship the whole thing back. A month later, we finally got the product that we wanted to have. Actually, this one didn't make the lineup. But it still took some time to produce. I'll spare you all the stories about the production, which is a whole different drama altogether. But in April, the first box came off the line, and we actually packed it ourselves. We packed the first 100 ourselves, and I just, you know, put a little number on all of them. And Georgi is the Bulgarian factory owner who helped us. He looks thrilled as well. So finally, we could present the Virgin Collection, which I hope you'll agree with me looks pretty much like the sketches that I showed you at the beginning. So, four classic sneakers made of biodegradable materials. They carry seeds in the tongue of the shoe. The little black dots are the seeds. And of course, a little manual to, you know, make people bury the shoe. Of course, we tested it, if it'll go forward. Yes. This is a shopping window in Amsterdam where we buried the shoes, just to show the public what would happen if you buried them. So here you see the plants coming out and the shoes slowly decaying. And after 2 months, the shoes look like this. And there's probably not many shoe company owners that are proud to show you a rotten, decayed shoe, but I was really satisfied with this result. And now, of course, now that we've made the most technically difficult product that you can make in the fashion industry, we realized that we can basically make everything bloom. We've got a ton of ideas, and we're just really excited for the future to start developing this. Now, I didn't tell you that OAT, the logo, is a circle, a triangle, and a plus, and they represent our core values: unite, create, and inspire. So I hope this short description of what we've done inspired you to think, at least, that as long as you believe in something, you might not know how to go about it, you might not have any experience doing it, but as long as you believe that it's possible, it actually is possible, as long as you keep at it. I also invite you to join us in this mission to make the world bloom. There's incredible power in this room, so I invite all of you, if you're maybe you're a major media outlet, you're good. You can help us out. Or maybe you're a large chemical company capable of making biodegradable glue, BASF. What, sorry?
Coffins.
Coffins that bloom. That's actually an idea I had. Let's go. Shh. It's a secret. But also, just, you know, if you have small ideas for it, maybe you have materials that we don't know of, or maybe you have an idea for a product, just you know, after the talk, please approach me, and or go to the website and find my email, and we can talk about this, and then together we can create products that'll make the world bloom. Thank you very much.